This is ThinkTech Hawaii. Community matters here.
Aloha, and how you doing? Gordo the Tech Star here. Welcome to another exciting and thrilling episode of Hibachi Talk. I am here with Andrew, the security guy.
Hey, everybody.
Aloha. It's been so long since you've been here.
Like, not that long.
I almost forgot your name.
Dude, I went to a lot of shows.
You went to a lot of shows, and we're going to talk about
that. We'll talk about what if I brought back anything useful or not.
Yeah, we'll find out for sure.
That's usually my mission.
You're my guest today. Guest and my pest today.
Thank you very much.
grab a libation, pull up a chair, and join us for another exciting and thrilling episode of Hibachi Talk. When Hibachi talks, the
people
world
listen.
Oh, you got people listening.
The world listens.
Oh, yeah, I don't know.
I've been gone so long, I don't remember our tagline.
Anyway,
I think today's tagline was like, because communication is critical.
Communication is critical. And we're going to talk about communications today. So we're going to talk about, all kinds of aspects of communication. Not just about,
audio.
And visual and all the kinds of things that happen. But related to security.
Yeah.
Right?
That's what I've been dealing with.
So what have you been doing?
Sure.
Where have you been?
I had a show called Total Tech Summit on the East Coast in Orlando.
Okay.
That is a really interesting group where they brought together your CE Pro guys, which are like
your... CE Pro guy?
Yeah, those are the integrators that do like your event shows, like, big screen, big audio. They might even do concerts and things like that.
Okay.
So your professional AV guys, right? That tend to do events. And then we had the the IC group, which is really more high-end home automation. They might do control rooms for business, but think of like hotel event rooms, things like that. Down to consumer level, the home theater stuff like that, right? So these are really separate industry groups. And they manage themselves, their businesses run differently. And so last year they brought the security integrators in there too. First time they'd ever had us. They've been doing this for like 10 years.
Right.
So they brought us. So this year was the second edition where we had security guys in there. And it's quite interesting to, first of all, learn how much of what we do is similar. You know, we're doing security, so our outcomes are a little heavier.
So these are not guys that are producing events and want security there. These are guys that want to integrate the security solutions into their audio video product line?
Really, not necessarily. But as we talk, they're like, and I find out what they do. These are guys who do audio video systems. They deliver them sometimes like for an event or sometimes permanent, like for a conference room at a hotel or something
Intercom system or whatever.
They do audio, like we do intercom. Their audio tends to be like the little, a push to talk microphone, wireless, for a big room of 500 people or whatever it may be. So, little different type of audio equipment. When we talk about what we do, they talk about what they do, and it's like, wow, I didn't even know that's a business. Like, the things they do sound really fun to me.
Right.
Because, when I'm done, everybody loves the security aspect, but it's heavy. They want the training, but I make sure everything's working right. And it's,
we're not protecting in the entertainment industry.
Yeah, we're protecting lives and property, right? When they get done, everybody got some big screen and loud audio, and they have a lot of fun with it, right?
So I'm still trying to figure out where the fit is. Why would they bring you into this, other than the fact that you all...
Low voltage.
Have audio. Oh, okay, so low voltage.
We're all low voltage system installers.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing about meeting with that group is, as much as security, and you hear me beating on security and the cybersecurity of our devices, well, AV systems have moved onto the network.
They're
very recently.
They're very technical. They're the Internet of Things.
Yes.
I can get onto your DVR or whatever it is.
Your screen,
your TV.
Whatever. All that stuff is moved onto the network as well, and is even less secure than a lot of our stuff. So I was there to talk about that, because I work with UL on those cyber standards. So I did a talk on that stuff while I was there. But the meetings that we had to help understand each other's types of business, because we've done a little bit of AV, but we are a security company.
Right.
And some of them, as AV companies, have done a little bit of security sometimes, but we're all trying to figure out, wow, how do I get in that business? Is there a market for it in Hawaii that I could get in? So I really learned a lot about all these very different types of business, which is for us pulling cable, dropping these systems onto the network, right? They're IP-based devices, configuring them for the, you know, it's all the same thing. It's just a different type of system.
Well, I'm seeing things of it. I'll use Alexa as an example, because Alexa's got, you know, that connectivity of that particular
voice control,
device, voice control device. It's listening all the time.
Oh, yeah.
I've learned a couple times by mistake. It said I didn't understand the question. I went, I wasn't even talking to you yet.
That's right.
So you know it's listening. Mm-hmm. But now I'm going like, oh, how secure is this thing on my network?
Well, not at all. It shouldn't be on your, like, make sure it's on your DMZ. Push it, you know, get it on its own network.
But, you know, I mean, but people's homes, they don't have it on their DMZ. They got to sit on
their
network.
But they should. I mean, that's a flaw in their network design.
Yeah, right. You know? I can see Ma and Pa sitting there. So, hey, Ma, you got the DMZ all set up?
Well, I mean, just set it out in the guest network and leave your PC on its own network.
On the production network.
Put all that other garbage, you know, somewhere else.
You're calling Alexa
Firewall
garbage?
I'm calling all of it garbage.
Alexa, do you want to respond to that?
Oh.
She's right there. Look.
Sorry, I don't know that.
Sorry, Alexa.
See, Alexa, I told you, right?
Yeah. But anyway, so that first show was it's really fun. That's my second year going there, and I appreciate the lessons that I learned from other integrators about the type of business that they do, and you know, so that's a great kickoff. You know, so you get to Orlando, which is, you know, 6 hours away,
right,
and, you know, kind of bleary eyed, but get on
six
stage.
Hours away, and how many hours of flying? 12 plus.
Yeah.
So it ends up being a 24-hour day to get to Orlando.
It's a hassle.
Yeah.
You know, but I got there and got that one done, and I mean, the next morning I'm out to Bovino, Italy.
Okay.
Yeah, which is up north of Milan.
Okay.
I'm there with a group, which is kind of going to be our focus, maybe in our second half today, from Zenitel, which is an international communications company. They have been around forever. They're out of Europe, and their products, you know, they're in maritime, they're on gas platforms. They really are the product for those environments, you know, so because they're in the Arctic, they're in the Sahara, they're in, you know, they're all over the place. And they're also they're a device that we use in the security industry, which is how I know of them. But they make many other types of communication products for a broad spectrum of industry.
Okay, so let's come back to Florida, though. When you went to Florida, you went to, because we'll go talk about Milan in the second half.
Okay.
But let's come back to Florida. Were you there just to learn, or were you presenting, or?
I present on cyber, so that's what they asked me to talk about. So I did that bit. That was pretty simple. And then the rest of the time, there's a small trade show with maybe 200 booths of product. Much of it I've never seen, because it's not like it's AV, it's CE Pro, it's all this other type of stuff. Very little security booth.
Sounds like something I'd like.
Stuff. Yeah, it's fun stuff. Amazing stuff. You know, big high resolution screens, all this. And then there's class after class after class. So you're a host, you're a guest.
Okay.
So they've paid your expenses to be there.
Okay.
But you are worked. So
yeah, you got to work.
You got to meet a lot of vendors.
So you have a lot of vendors coming, talking to you about.
They move you around to them. So
securing their devices, securing their services, or
they're mostly trying to sign you on as a dealer, things like that. So you know, some of the rooms are like many of your appointments are. You go in, there may be a group of 10 or 12 of you, and they're going to do like a 30-minute presentation about their technology or their services or whatever they offer, and so you're kind of moving pretty. You might have 8 of them in a day.
So was there a lot of physical security, like cameras, access control type vendors at this event?
Just a few. So Goidebruck was there out of Germany, who I'm familiar with, but I got to know a lot better. I hadn't ever, you know, played with their product or got to meet those folks. Who else was there? V5 was there, which I'm familiar a little bit from the DoD side, but they're fairly new. They're a portable mobile sensor type thing. So they drop in a solar panel to power their gear, battery backed up, you know, so that it's driving off the battery, but they're charging the battery all the time. And then it's a camera, maybe with, you know, gunshots detection on it, maybe with sensing chemicals,
some kind
chemical
of recording,
sensors on it. So, yeah.
Internet access.
Yeah, well, IP-based, sure.
IP-based,
so you're
going
it's got a router and everything built in, so you're going to, you know, be on a VPN, maybe pulling the data back out of it. But it's kind of like a remote sensor, and they're really designed to go on a pole or on the side of a building pretty quickly. Then maybe it's not going to be permanent. It could be, but, you know, it's kind of pricey, so you wouldn't do it permanently.
So
there's cheaper ways.
If a dignitary was coming into a particular town, going down a particular street, mm-hmm. they could get these things up.
On poles or something, sure, quickly.
Be able to do that monitoring quickly and so on. It's interesting. I'm finding it just fascinating. Because, but this is the AV industry, which is now bringing
mixed with
this
the security
together.
Guys, sure. Yeah, and it's kind of neat, you know. And I ran into these other guys that do access control with all this Bluetooth stuff, and I was like, so it to me.
Yeah, but how secure is that?
Yeah, it didn't meet to really to the security standards I would be looking for in equipment, but it's an interesting way because, you know, they've saved a whole lot of money. So if you don't have a really high-profile asset, just for example, broom closets maybe you have just maintenance closets with you know, not expensive stuff in them, or you need to do an access control implementation that's thin, that maybe you can just use your phone to get in and out of, you know, maybe there's a place for it in the market. It's below the market I'm in, but it's American-made stuff. So, you know, I spent a half hour with them, went to their booth, and walked through there, and it was all cloud-based. You know, it's pure IoT play where these devices are all talking up to the cloud, and, you know, you're accessing it through the cloud. So, very, very unique toys and unique applications, and, you know, it's amazing.
But I think I have clients who have come to me and said, okay, we want to put in this access control security system, mm-hmm. but we just want it to read our phone that's in our pocket mm-hmm. as I walk by.
Yeah.
And I'm going,
probably not.
But how secure is that? I mean, because I can get hack your phone. I can certainly get that mm-hmm. Bluetooth access piece. I don't find it that secure.
It isn't. It's definitely not what we're used to dealing from the regulated industries where we work, you know, obviously. But there's probably a place for it for some types of people. And it's all has to do with that risk assessment, you know, and really understanding where this product could live for you, how it could be utilized. Because if we're still in this world today where, you know, electronic hardwired access control doors can be $3,000 to $5,000 a door. You know,
they're expensive.
We've been talking about those prices for years. They haven't changed much.
I tell clients when I talk to them, I said, go upwards of $10,000 a door, depending on what it is you want to do with that door.
Yeah, if they're glass or historical, all those sort of problems.
Or they want automatic opening, you know, not just read it, but I want it to then open automatically.
Like magic.
Oh, and then, by the way, I want it has to be tied into the fire system and all this kind of stuff.
And it has to close again, too, by the way.
Yeah, it has to close and lock, by the way. By the way, I want a record of all of that, along with the video shot of it as well.
Yeah.
And then integrate that in so I can see a report every day on what happened. Mm-hmm. Okay, now you're at $10,000 a door.
Yeah.
And
I know we've done some historical doors here in Hawaii that you can't put any cabling or anything. So we end up going to the hardware inside the door, and you got to go with wireless. And I mean, I think some of these applications were $20,000, $30,000.
Yeah.
You know, their main door, they're really big, but that's the only option because there's can't be boring holes through the walls and mounting readers
or
on the walls.
Nice, boring, ugly, nice holes through this beautiful koa wood door that's been around for 125 years.
Yeah. So those prices are crazy. And so when you can get down to these lighter weight applications, you know, again, depending on the assets you're protecting, you know, there's perhaps a place for this, but the evolution of technology, and especially that they're appealing to all those kind of people, I think they're looking kind of more consumer level with those types of products, and there's definitely a group of those folks at Total Tech Summit that are servicing that market.
Wow.
But, you know, if you put in a home theater, you might not want your expensive home theater. You may not want your 8 or 12 year, maybe your 15 year old in there. So maybe you throw a little something like that on the door. So if at least he goes in, you know he's in there.
Yeah, went in
or
there.
Or something
you
like that.
Stole your wine.
Your wine room's
your
in there.
Wine room too.
Could be.
Okay, we covered the first half.
All right.
That was a good how it goes fast. Now we're going to talk about Milan when you come back and what happened when you were there.
Right on.
So Gordo the tech czar, Andrew the security guy. Oh, Angus has a question for you. So he's going to have
We
need that. So we'll be back in a minute.
This is ThinkTech Hawaii, raising public awareness.
Some say scuba divers are the poor man's astronaut. At Dive Heart, we believe that to be true. We say forget the moon. Dive Heart can help children, adults, and veterans of all abilities escape gravity right here on Earth. Search diveheart.org and imagine the possibilities in your life.
Match day is no ordinary day. The pitch, hallowed ground for players and supporters alike. Excitement builds. Game plans are made with responsibility in mind. Celebrations are underway. Ready for kickoff, MLS clubs and our supporters rise to the challenge. We make responsible decisions while we cheer on our heroes and toast their success. Elevate your match day experience. If you drink, never drive.
Hey everybody, aloha. Welcome back to ThinkTech Hawaii. This is Hibachi Talk. I'm Andrew, the security guy, and Angus is here off the beach. Angus, what's going on, buddy? I haven't seen you in a while.
How you doing, Andrew? It's good to see you, man. You're looking really, you're really a little spiffy today.
Thank you. I've got a collar on.
You got a wee bit chilly today. You got a long sleeve shirt on.
It's winter.
It's winter time. I know. I'm freezing my alcohol off in my kilt.
I understand.
Anyway, you know, the show's about communications, and I wanted to be thematic. So okay. I was walking along Kapi'olani Boulevard the other day there, and I took a picture of this particular building.
Okay.
And I want you to tell me what you think's wrong with this picture.
What's wrong with it?
It looks like it's
Kirk. I mean, I see some graffiti on there.
Yeah,
I see the windows. I don't know.
Yeah, well, there may not be any security.
There may not be any. I don't know. It's hard to tell from the outside.
But how do you have your campaign headquarters all covered in graffiti?
Well, and you can't see what's going on inside either. So
I never thought of that.
Could be grim, but I don't see anything on the windows. Maybe there might be tape there.
There's no security there. That's my whole point. That's what's wrong with that picture.
Maybe there's nothing in there worth protecting. Well, okay.
Now I'll leave you down with that one. That's you made that call, not mine.
That's one side of the coin.
It could be right.
You have to know where your assets
are. It's in camouflage. That's what it is.
And there's always people in there working, right? So typically, a guy like me is going to want access control on the door.
You would. Well, at least not let someone know you're going to.
And especially like a political building, right? Because somebody might not like that particular candidate and try to go in there and cause trouble.
Well, obviously someone didn't. They put all that stuff on the wall.
I saw that graffiti. You think that was there before?
I didn't again. But if you moved in with it on the wall, I'd be even more scared.
And didn't paint it.
That tells a really great story.
Maybe they didn't want to spend any campaign money on paint.
Ah, hi, lad. You got it. Anyway, that was my wee little thematic piece in what's going on. Anyway, well, like I say every show, let your wing gang be wherever you be. Aloha.
All right. Angus bringing us look like Caldwell Campaign Center there. It maybe needs a little help. So give us a call, Kirk, if you need some security on there. we know we're handling a lot of stuff around the city for you, but your office is important too, I imagine. Anyway, Gordo's back, and we're talking a little bit about communications today, and communications being critical. Yeah, I had Orlando.
Orlando, and then now you're off to Italy.
And this was via JFK, so it's Orlando to New York JFK overnight. Get there, briefing for the presentation.
And you were presenting there also.
Yes.
You're a very famous guy.
No, not at all.
Or infamous.
And I learned something about presenting 44 different countries represented at this.
44 different countries. Oh, so they had the kind?
They all speak English.
Okay.
But. Andrew speaks too fast.
Oh, okay.
So it's a real skill if you're presenting to an international audience who, has English. As a probably a second language or whatever it might be,
third or fourth.
They can definitely speak and understand, but you've got to speak slowly. And so I'm up there like most of the day, the first day. And so Ron, the guy Ron Warman, is like he's the moderator for the day, and he's trying to
slow down.
So he made me repeat myself a few times and plus I'm bleary from like no sleep, like it's weird, right? It's actually 12 hours difference from Hawaii. So at this point, I've been on the road 5 days. I'm 12 hours away. It's a mess.
But you're the Hawaii boy.
Yes.
In Milan with 44 countries in presence. And what the hell are you talking about? Kentucky bourbon.
They definitely brought me for the integrator perspective on comms, right?
So integrator perspective on communications.
Yeah, and communications get left out of a lot of security scenarios. A lot of people think cameras, right, being able to see into a site or have IDS, intrusion detection sensors where you can tell that a door's been opened or there's motion.
Right.
So you're getting some information back. But a lot of people leave audio out of those solutions in building and security management. And so you know, the audio is that really missing piece that gives you command and control. Because, if you can see someone doing something on a video monitor because you've got a camera there, but you have no way to interact with them or tell them to stop, all you can do is watch what's going on remotely. It's kind of run to get there. Yeah, and it's a little bit helpless, right? The good thing about the video is you can see if you are sending a response unit, are the people armed or whatever. So you can kind of see what you're walking into. But if you've got audio there, you can just talk to them. You can identify yourself. This is Integrated Security Technologies. Please identify yourself.
Please stop what you're doing, sir.
Exactly. So you start to engage into a site, as well as you can also listen from the site. So it's two-way. This particular group, Zenitel's very well known for the clarity of their audio. So their stuff is top-notch. They have some technology they developed called a turbine. which is a speaker that I don't know offhand if it outperforms most intercoms like by 50 feet or whatever. I actually use it on my building, and you can hear it all the way across the parking lot crystal clear. But I'm sure you've been to many facilities where you're trying to like go in their parking garage or whatever.
Oh, you can't even hear the...
And it's useless communications for security.
Right.
So there was a lot of discussion. This group that was there really... A large maritime contingent, so they sell these products onto ships in the freight industries, right? And also like the oil and gas platforms out there. And so the things that those folks are doing, as well as just refineries and situations like that. So when you're in those types of environments, almost everything you do is safety conscious, kind of like a mining operation. And they're also in mining operations, as a matter of fact. And so when you have people doing a task, typically you've got someone assigned to watch them to make sure something occurs, or they're watching gauges, ooh, there's pressure building, leave the area, or whatever it may, because there's fluids moving, there's heat, there's temperature, there's a lot of really dangerous equipment in those types of facilities.
And whether it be an oil platform or anything.
And it's dynamic, it's changing all the time. Right. So they operate with that, you know, that level of oversight. And you know, they were giving some examples of some of the guys, they were telling us years ago how they'd been to a refinery facilities, you know, with a 7-mile perimeter, and they've got work going on, and their method of communicating, is everybody okay, was to tap with a hammer like 4 times, and then the guy that's 500 yards away heard it, he'd tap 4 times.
Sounds like a smoke signal kind of thing.
Sort of, yeah. And so then it'd go down and it'd work its way back, and then, you know, by the time it went 5 miles and they all tapped their way back, the guy got, okay, everybody's okay. But it could take 5 minutes.
So
it was very problematic.
And what about those, but we moved up, we have walkie-talkies now, we have cell phones.
Exactly, so the ability for that maybe that command center guy to send that communication information, and for it to be clearly heard, first time, every time. So the real neat thing about being with Zenitel at this particular event, this was a global rollout for a new messaging campaign of theirs, which is, you know, because communication is critical. You know, rarely is somebody saying something, well, maybe in my case, I'm yapping about stuff all the time, it's not important. But in a safety and security environment, typically when you're communicating something, it's critical.
Well, yeah,
and it needs to be delivered first time, every time.
And so, if you're running a command center?
Oh, definitely.
You're running a command center. I mean, you know, people have heard the word like 10-4, right? You know, all the different numbers that mean certain things. Those are the ways that they could at least communicate clearly on what that meant versus if someone was to say the words.
Yeah.
Because the words could get cut off.
Yeah, and we even to this day will spell street names phonetically. You know, like Kukui would be, you know, Kilo Uniform Kilo.
Yeah.
You know, Uniform India, right? Yeah. So you know, so that because Kukui's just not common.
Just not going
to
work.
Depending on who you're talking to, they may not come across.
Right.
But if you're using Zenitel, you're going to hear clearly Kukui. You just may not know what it was or how to spell it. So, interestingly, we did a really good sit down session with these groups where they gave us. Like a problem from their industry. And this group that I proctored was really fun because they were talking about, I guess, oil and gas platforms have gone, let's just say there was, you know, 5,000 of them. There's now only like 3,500. So they've really been reduced globally. So that market's shrinking. So, you know, these guys are all trying to figure out how to create a market. But what's happened out there in the world, and I don't know if we have this here, and I couldn't recall, but they're mounting windmills on platforms now at sea because they're unsightly on land.
Right.
So they'll put a bunch of them out at sea.
I've seen those, yes.
And so these things need maintenance. So the interesting challenge about that is sometimes it's a boat because it has to be towed in for service.
Right.
Sometimes it's a platform.
Sometimes a platform that's anchored in the spot.
Yeah, and they have different types of rules for that. So we thought that's a market that ought to be attacked to make up for the loss of this other market. And it was kind of interesting presentation, but really smart groups who I think really sort of discovered a market that they should go after while we were just having this
So I'm thinking I've got a field of antennas that are in the middle of the ocean somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to obviously need cameras that are monitoring what's going on in the area.
And talk when people go out there, so you have to be able to talk to
audio,
them. So
then you got to have audio to go out because you got maintenance records and all those kinds of stuff. You don't wait for it to break down. You do PM and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, we came up with like a floating mesh network because sometimes they break away in a storm and one will start drifting off. So you know you got to the team that goes to get that still needs to be able to talk. So, you know, we needed a mesh networking type idea to put this all on so it would all work together, even though they could be, I think they said like a half a mile apart or something like that. Yeah. So it's kind of big, you know, it's not like they're all side by side. So pretty interesting.
That's interesting.
Yeah, really, really great ideas for ways to use communications and you know, show you the importance of being able to communicate.
So of all the stuff that went on, give me one of the biggest things that hit you, like, oh my goodness, this is like unbelievable.
Well, that was at the next show.
Okay.
So I'm in Italy 3 days. Right. I mean, I landed, I did this show for 2 days. I'm on a plane back to Orlando for another show via New York.
All right.
I get there. Now I'm 7-8 days out. I'm fuzzy brain.
Brain
I
dead.
I'm having trouble. This was ConnectWise. It's called IT Nation. Now, ConnectWise is a sort of a management CRM platform, project management,
customer
marketing,
resource management
everything.
Stuff.
And these guys have tied in Cisco Spark. They've tied in Microsoft's Office 365 now. They've also tied in security products. So you can run this product where we use it for CRM and project management.
Customer resource management.
These guys have taken it out as a full-blown managed service platform to monitor these other types of systems that are out there, including some security equipment. A product called Genetech, which you've probably heard of, is integrated to it now. So, and these guys are all out of Canada. I had never been to their conference before. IT Nation, their main product is called ConnectWise. There are many users here, sure.
Yep.
But what they're doing with it is phenomenal. And they announced a $25 million grant to companies that they're going to help build the APIs to bring in more integration partners. And they had hundreds already in this ecosystem there. So really interesting. I'm like, I missed the ball with what we could actually do with this product
for our organization. I'm thinking retirement's going to come sooner. I mean, we got a minute left, so, and you don't get a solo cup because you have as many as you want before we close out. But any last message you want to get out on this?
Pretty
fascinating.
The thing that we really learned, Lamarce, that it really brought it to focus for me was, you know, hear, be heard, first time, every time, you know, because communication is critical. And, you know, think about adding audio into your security solutions because it's a major component and there's a lot to be learned from it.
Yeah, that's the part that I've learned from. What I got from this show is I'm always thinking of the access control, your ID card, you know,
and the
camera
video.
And the video, but I've never thought about adding that audio piece to it, but you can start to realize it really isn't important.
Yeah, and it's probably necessary.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Anyway, this has been Hibachi Talk. When Hibachi talks, the world listens.
People listen.
We have to refine our tagline.
We got to work on it.
You're going to have your own.
We got to get it in stereo.
Be sure to watch us every Wednesday at 1:00 live, and then we're back on YouTube. And if you haven't funded our fund campaign, please contribute to the fund campaign and try to help us so we can keep this thing going. We volunteer our time and everything, and we got to keep these lights on. And
yeah, we got a lot to share with the community.
And lots to share in the community. We want to keep this stuff going, so please do that for us. Anyway, thanks a lot, Andrew. And like we say at the end of every show, 1, 2, 3.
How you doing?